frightening subject of mid-air collisions. There is nothing more ominous to the millions of us who fly an airplane than the thought of two or more of them colliding in mid-air. As, for instance, two did over San Diego, California back in 1978. It doesn't happen often, but when it does, the consequences are so awful that the aviation industry has been trying to come up with a backup device to warn planes, to warn pilots when they are too close together, when they had better separate or risk collision. Well, remarkably, after 25 years of research and development, after spending who knows how many millions of dollars, we still have no such device. Pilots must still depend on their limited vision and on the overworked and sometimes fallible ground control system. Why? The answer comes in a strange and complicated bureaucratic tale.
Every day, 810,000 passengers entrust their lives to commercial pilots like Harris Dexter. Dex has been an airline pilot for 26 years, the last 18 of them flying 727s for a major U.S. airline. Near misses are a frighteningly common occurrence, he says. And to demonstrate, he took us up 5,000 feet over the Los Angeles-San Diego corridor, one of the busiest in the nation.
Here's one, he's up there, he's coming. He was coming to us at 12 o'clock and he's coming in at 3. In other words, it's dead wrong and he's coming pretty darn close.
That's true.
My point, all that has to do is we started a turn.
Would that be considered a near miss or no?
You mean that?
Nothing.
That's nothing.
And he still came pretty close.
That's right. But there have been many times when I passed within 200 or 300 feet of airplanes. If I didn't spot when they were giving to me, they caught it this one by. Even a 747, 6 miles away, is trying to cut the sea.
All right. Now, what if you had, in this San Diego business, what if those planes had had airborne collision avoidance?
Then the accident would not have happened.
As simple as that.
Simple as that.
We'll get to airborne collision avoidance in a moment. First, let's remember San Diego. The mid-air collision of this Pacific Southwest jet and a small Cessna over San Diego in September of 1978 is what this report is really all about. Experts tell us it's only a matter of time before there's another such disaster. It was by no means the nation's first mid-air collision. January 31st, 1957.
Disaster in the sky over California. Around Pacoima Junior High School in Van Nuys, California, 20,000 feet up in the clear skies, an F-98 Scorpion jet and a huge DC-7 transport collided, killing five of the six men aboard the two planes.
Grand Canyon, June 30, 1956. A TWA and a United DC-7 collide, 128 killed. That was 25 years ago and sparked the first outcry for a collision warning system. New York, December 16, 1960. Again, TWA and United, 134 killed. Hendersonville, North Carolina, 1967. 82 died.
There hasn't been a commercial airline mid-air crash since this San Diego disaster claimed 144 lives. In fact, 1980 turned out to be the safest year in U.S. aviation history. But since 1956, approximately 1,500 people have lost their lives in mid-air plane crashes.
It's only the tip of the iceberg when you look at the number of near misses reported. Because normally we report the ones where we have to take evasive action. There's also many targets we have never seen. We don't know how close we came to them, how close they came to us. And it's a serious problem, and I think we need to be dealt with.
Well, as we've said, for 25 years, the aviation industry has been trying to come up with an electronic device that would keep planes from colliding in midair. And back in 1975, the Honeywell Corporation believed they were successful, that they had developed an ACAS, that is short for Airborne Collision Avoidance System. A visual display in the cockpit, independent of the ground, would tell a pilot when he was too close to another plane, when he should climb or dive to avoid a collision. In order to work, both planes, all planes, would have to have an ACAS. The cost? A relatively inexpensive $1,200 for a small plane owner, $12,000 for a commercial airliner. And the Honeywell people were so sure their ACAS system was going to be adopted, they even advertised it on 60 Minutes early in 1976.
Someday, there'll be a small, inexpensive device available that will help pilots and ground controllers prevent mid-air collisions. Once it's on board all
scientists and engineers and pilots endorse their efforts, including James Polk, himself a pilot.
Polk has staked a career and perhaps ruined a career on this issue of collision avoidance. He had been with the FAA in Washington for years. He had the impressive title of chief of the Industry and Government Liaison Division, was earning $50,000 a year. And with the fervor of a religious zealot, Jim Polk insisted to anyone who would listen that the Honeywell ACAS did work.
You're saying that ACAS, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, was proven, workable, effective, doable.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
And the FAA itself acknowledged that.
That's what I'm saying. They have reports available that say this.
And then turn comes down.
Exactly.
Question, why?
The question is answered by an acronym, NIH, not invented here. If the FAA didn't invent it, they're not going to use it.
Jim Pope, I know that's the way you feel. You'll forgive me if I find it difficult to believe. You mean just because it wasn't embedded inside the system?
Exactly, and that's what makes it so scurrilous. The fact that here was a device, like you said, proven effective in 1975, 3 years before the San Diego accident, and the FAA said we can't use it because it doesn't fit harmoniously in with our system. And the second thing is, ACAS would put more responsibility into the cockpit where it belongs and less on the ground. And this, of course, would mean, in the long run, less air traffic controllers.
So what you're saying is that they are against ACAS because they're empire building, they want more air traffic controllers, they want more people working for the FAA?
Exactly, it's self-propagation, pure and simple.
What happened when Jim Polk blew the whistle?
The FAA didn't fire him, he is still drawing his salary of $50,000 a year, but he is drawing it here in Seattle, Washington, where he was exiled almost 2 years ago.
The FAA replies that it was a routine transfer, not retribution for his whistleblowing. Besides, says the FAA, we have something a good deal better than ACAS. BCAS, it's called. Developed under FAA auspices and supervision with FAA money. And best of all, they say it will fit harmoniously into their air traffic control system because, unlike ACAS, it is part of the ground control system. And of course, that is largely what this controversy is all about.
The flying laboratory, the FAA's Boeing 727, is equipped with an active BCAS experimental unit.
They've even prepared a film to show how it will work.
The experimental unit, developed by Lincoln Laboratories of Bedford, Massachusetts, seeks out and receives replies from aircraft within a 14-mile radius. It interrogates from antennas on the top and bottom of the fuselage, looking for traffic above and below.
There is one catch, though. Unlike ACAS, which was said to be virtually ready to go 6 years ago, BCAS, in 1981, is still not ready for installation in airplanes. Its chief shortcoming, a problem not yet solved, is the interference it causes in dense terminal areas. And that's where it's needed most, because that's where most mid-air collisions are likely to occur. But despite that, Dr. Clyde Miller, manager of the FAA's Collision Avoidance Program, says he's delighted with the BCAS development.
It is working just super.
Really?
Really.
In all areas?
It'll work. We have flight tested that system over 250 hours or so now.
Mm-hmm.
And it is working, it seems, very reliably in all the areas, except for Los Angeles.
And remember, Los Angeles is one of the busiest airports in the nation. And as we said, busy airports are where a foolproof collision avoidance system is needed most.
Under what circumstances would you turn BCAS off?
There is no current proposal in today's air traffic environment for turning BCAS off,
even in a dense area.
Ah.
Let me change that answer just a little bit in this sense. Under what circumstances would you turn BCAS off?
When you're within a mile and a half or so of the airport.
And that, of course, is the problem. The question is, why is the FAA willing to grapple with BCAS problems, but was unwilling to solve ACAS shortcomings? Jim Polk has given some of the reasons, but another reason was, we are told, the small plane lobby didn't want ACAS because they knew that if it was made mandatory, every small plane owner would have to buy one at a cost of $1,200. Ironically, it is not clear yet whether those same small planes will need extra equipment before BCAS is finally effective. But there were said to be other problems with ACAS. False alarms, for one thing. And Pope called our attention to several FAA-sponsored reports. MITRE, Institute for Defense Analysis, Naval Air Development Center, which concluded that those problems were easily surmountable. Wrong, all wrong, Dr. Miller told us. So we confronted him with the confidential minutes from a critical FAA executive committee meeting.
This is December 1975. Improving protection against mid-air collisions. Top man at the agency, summarizing the meeting, says, in view of the fact that three ACAS systems have been tested and one of them meets all the objectives of the agency, and you're telling me, and you are not the administrator, you're telling me it doesn't work. In other words, the boss was wrong. The boss was wrong. ACAS does not work, did not work, as a collision avoidance system in 1975 or in 1981. And the assumption that everybody has an ACAS on his aircraft is optimism at its best.
Tom Emley was another FAA engineer who says that he got a taste of how the FAA might ostracize someone who didn't agree with him. For 9 years, until he took early retirement a year ago, Emley was a senior electronic engineer at the FAA. He endorses ACAS and Jim Pope's position.
I admire the guy. Other people have said he's irrational for being angry and bucking the system, but if he feels strongly, I think the system needs more, not just the FAA, the whole system. Industry as well as government needs more Jim Popes to say this by damn is right, and I'm going to say it. Do you believe that his charges against FAA concerning ACAS are essentially correct?
Of course.
The document, we have piles of documents which support what he says. That is to say, ACAS was tested thoroughly, and it works. And yet the FAA has abandoned ACAS, and the question is why?
You have to put yourself in their shoes, Mike. They've been telling the Congress and the aviation trade press for 10 years now how well their ground-derived system will work, and that the ACAS won't work.
We'll get to that ground-derived system in a moment.
Now, picture yourself as a bureaucrat in the FAA, and your job is to go up and tell the truth to the Congress.
Are you saying to me that the FAA people who testified before the Congress are lying about ACAS?
I won't use that word. I will say their testimony is less than accurate.
If anyone should have been able to tell us whether ACAS worked and why it was rejected, it ought to be Honeywell. We wanted to ask them, among other things, about any political pressures they believe might have been applied to the FAA decision against ACAS. But they refused to talk to us.
And you know the reason they won't?
Why?
Intimidation? Subtle blackmail? And I don't just say that. I've talked to the people at Honeywell, and back as far as 1975 and 6. And I said, can we expect that you would, what, go to Congress and make your point known? Once they would go to Congress and sidestep the FAA, from that point on, they'd never get another FAA contract.
We're not through yet. BCAS, as such, would be only a stepping stone to another FAA system on the drawing board, what Tom Emley has just referred to as the ground-derived system, what the FAA calls DAVS-ATARS. Big and expensive, the linchpin of the FAA's anti-collision effort. Yet we've been told ACAS would have made it largely obsolete. Its major function? To assist pilots in their high-density airspace where BCAS doesn't work. But it won't be ready until 1990 at the earliest, they say. And it's totally dependent on that sometimes fallible ground control system. Besides, Tom Emley says it may do precisely what it's intended not to do, increase the prospect of mid-air collisions. And the cost? $1 billion to begin with. It's all those dollars and the never-ending dispute that has exasperated California Congressman John Burton for years. Burton has been jousting with the FAA for some time in his role as chairman of the House subcommittee that has oversight responsibility for the agency.
All our committee can do is keep kicking them in the pants. We give them the kick in the pants when we ask them how much 2 and 2 is, and they start talking about, you mean new math, old math, or do you want to go back to Arabic? In other words, they don't give you straight answers. They give you gobbledygook. These things were developed by the private sector. Why didn't they go in and spend some more money and cure the defect? We've got the scientific technology to do that. I mean, they find the defect, they don't try to correct it, they use it as an excuse to 86, if you will, anything that is not tied into their ground control system, because then it is not part of their empire.
Is there any realistic chance of reversing course now and having ACAS reconsidered and reinstated, or has it been passed by?
Well, that's the reason I'm here talking to you, Mike. I think the new administration has a golden opportunity to fix the air traffic control system permanently and save the taxpayers $500 million. That's not bad.
Even with all this traumatic experience of being treated like a pariah and ostracized, I'm lucky. I'm still alive. There are 144 people down in San Diego that are dead, and how many more are being jeopardized every day? So as far as I'm concerned, there's something that needs to be done, and I'm going to do it.
What is the FAA's answer to all this? Less than 2 months ago, long after we began developing this report, the FAA spent $10,000 to hire a consultant on an urgent, sole-source basis. That means no competitive bidding. Quote, to reassess and revalidate the current technical and programmatic direction of its aircraft separation assurance programs. What that means is to look into the relative merits of ACAS and BCAS. That congressional hearing beginning Tuesday aims to do just that.